Hello, my friends, and welcome to the Curate Study for this, the third Sunday in Advent. My name is Reverend Mark Kerslake, and it is wonderful to have you here as we career headlong through the Advent season. Really now scant days to go before Christmas is upon us. And huge amounts happening across our mission community, just as I suspect huge amounts are happening in your personal lives. Work, Christmas parties in some form or other happening. Hopefully a bit less controversial than the Christmas party the government is alleged to have had last year. A bit of political stuff there for you. And Christmas present buying, organising to see family and friends, and generally rushing around. It's manic in our household. We've currently had a three-year-old and a seven-year-old staying with us. Many of you will know we also have four boys, young men actually, between 15 and 20. And we've also had number one son's girlfriend, lovely Meg, staying with us as well. So add that to the two dogs and the Christmas frenzy of service planning, plus Angie working full-time. It's all bonkers. Where can we go to find peace in this sort of chaos? We'll talk about that a bit later on. But before we go on into that part of our service, some notices. First thing is, watch our Facebook page. If you haven't signed up to it, I would suggest you do, East Clist Churches. The email that we send out every week goes out to over 200 people, but there's only about 130 of you signed up to our Facebook page, which means that you don't get the latest daily updates and news snippets that we post regularly on the Facebook page. You have to wait for a whole week to be able to catch up with news from my email I send out on a Sunday morning from the Curate Study. Think of all the stuff you're missing, because the stuff that goes on the Facebook page that never goes in the email and we never talk about here. So sign up now, East Clist Churches, the Facebook page. It's brilliant. Photographs, news, snippets of stuff that's happening around the diocese, all goes on there. And tell your friends about it. Now, if you signed up to that, you will see that there's lots of stuff coming up, and some of the stuff you have to book for. I'm not going to go into it all here, but with the new COVID restrictions, some of our popular services are booking only. So if you turn up without booking, you may not get in if they're very full, because we have to allow for social distancing. Also, one other thing to flag, I'm going to keep pushing this because it's really, really important for us as a mission community. The Alpha course that's going to start on the 24th of January, Monday the 24th of January. 10 informal sessions, conversation, the big questions of life and the Christian faith, with lots of time for questions, and smack bang in the middle of it, probably an opportunity for us to meet in person, COVID, Omicron and the rest allowing. So watch out for that. Drop me an email at info@eastclistchurches.org if you're interested, and I'll send you the information as soon as I get it. But it's going to be good. I know it's going to be good because Reverend James Greer, our diocesan mission enabler, is running it. Not boring old me. You won't have to listen to my voice. Reverend James Greer will be taking it. Okay, that was a lot, wasn't it? So let's prepare ourselves to dive in, because no matter who you are, what you believe, or where you are welcome with us as we explore a little bit about being a Christian today. So before we begin, our collect for the day. This is the church's prayer, which we sometimes call the collect. And the prayer, very similar to this, will be being read aloud in house churches through to grand cathedrals all around the world today. O Lord Jesus Christ, who at your first coming sent your messenger to prepare your way before you, grant that the ministers and stewards of your mysteries may likewise so prepare and make ready your way by turning the hearts of the disobedient to the wisdom of that at your second coming to judge the world. We may be found an acceptable people in your sight. For you are alive and reign with the Father in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. It's time for our first hymn now, a beautiful piece of traditional music, an Advent hymn, Tell Out My Soul.
Tell out my soul.
So before we listen to our Bible reading, we're going to do what we always going to do. We clear away the baggage we've accumulated over the last 7 days and possibly beyond by opening our hearts to God. We come to God as one from whom no secrets are hidden, to ask his forgiveness and peace. Lord God, we have sinned against you by avoiding your call. Our love for you is like the morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Have mercy on us. Deliver us from judgment. Bind up our wounds and revive us. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now may the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and give you his peace as he raises you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. So our Bible reading today is from the book of Philippians. Philippians 4, actually, beginning at verse 4. And the book of Philippians, if I can get it open to the right page, is a very short book, actually, short and snappy, written by the Apostle Paul, one of his letters to the church in Philippi, to Philippians, in other words, in the church in Philippi, which is one of the churches he planted. He travelled around that part of the world, planting churches, preaching the gospel of Christ. And then often he would write back to them, either in response to letters he'd had from them, which sadly we usually don't have, or because news had reached him of things that concerned him. And so he would write to them. So this Philippians 4, beginning at verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ, our Lord. A reflection on what we've just heard. Now, if you've just noticed that the camera has jumped, it's because I'm now on my third attempt to record this sermon. It's proving to be quite a stressful filming process, which is apt, given that this sermon is about finding peace in stressful times. You see, I'm under a bit of time pressure today because we record some days before Sunday, because this material has to be edited and then posted onto YouTube, and the email has to be written that comes with it if you're on our email list. So I have to fit it in the week. And even if I'm not preaching anywhere else, I have to write a sermon for this online service. This week, things are a little bit stressful, or increasingly stressful, as we're looking after a three-year-old and a seven-year-old. And in not very long, I've got to go and pick the three-year-old up from preschool this afternoon, because he finishes at 1 o'clock. And the clock is counting down on me. I've made three attempts to record the sermon, and every time I've done it, one of the dogs has done something, which has meant I'd had to stop. So it's ironic, isn't it? Because I desperately need to get this done to talk to you about finding peace in difficult times. I've got huge amounts to do. I'm prepping for three services this week, and several carol services and nativity plays for schools next week, plus trying to organise the wreath making course that's happening at Broadcliffe this afternoon, and another one that's happening tomorrow. And whilst also having the back of my mind, I'm away on Friday and Saturday for a friend's passing out parade up at Sandhurst. So I'm trying to juggle many, many things at the same time, and trying to fit in sort of 6 days worth of work, which is what I normally do each week, into 4 days, because the work isn't going to go away just because I have somewhere I have to go. I just have to try and somehow fit those two extra days work, those two sort of 10-hour days, somewhere into the days that I've got left. So it doesn't help when the dogs are not being helpful. Now, the reason I wanted to talk to you about peace and dealing with anxiety and stress was because Christmas is a really stressful time of year, isn't it, for many people? It really is. It adds a whole layer of other difficulties into your life, doesn't it? And unless you've been on Mars, you can't help but notice that we've been stricken with this dreadful virus for quite some time. And it seems reluctant to let go of us because now we have the Omicron variant, which seems to be pushing us back towards further restrictions. And general anxiety, overlaid with COVID anxiety, is now overlaid with anxiety about whether yet another Christmas will have to be cancelled because people end up in self-isolation, leaving aside the fact that masks are being brought back into in shops and public transport. And the figures, the doom-laden figures that the media are showing us, show the numbers of this new variant increasing dramatically every day, with the resultant pressure on our National Health Service. So, and that, of course, is on top of the ordinary worries that families will be going through at any time of the year. Health issues, relationship problems, money problems, concerns about work, etc., etc. So there once was a wise king who asked for a picture of peace. He asked his courtiers to send out the message around his kingdom if someone could design a message, a picture that he could hang in one of his staterooms, and when he was faced with difficult issues, he could gaze upon it, and it would inspire him as to how he would find peace when dealing with problems. And the picture he chose surprised his courtiers, because it was a picture of jagged black mountains pointing towards a doom-laden sky filled with storm clouds, in which lightning flashed, and in his imagination he could hear thunder echoing through the dark canyons beneath them. Down the side of one of the mountains, a massive waterfall plunged. Spray was thrown into the air. You could feel the cold mist on your skin if you closed your eyes and thought about it. And in a crevice in a rock underneath the waterfall, there was a tiny, tiny tree growing, clinging on by roots into the hard stone. And within it, a small mother bird had built a nest. The picture showed her sleeping, her eyes closed, apparently a perfect peace. The courtiers said to the king, "What on earth have you chosen this picture for?" And he said, "Because to be at peace is not to deny the storm, but to accept that it is happening, and the place you are in might be precarious, but somehow to be at peace with that and to find calm within yourself." Now, whenever angels turn up in lots of biblical passages, they start with either saying, "Peace be with you," or "Do not be afraid," which I can't help but think is somewhat ironic, given if the heavenly host turned up in my study when I was filming this, calm or not afraid would not be two either of the things that I would be feeling. And as I say, as we head towards Christmas, many of us will be feeling extremely stressed, anxious, worried, possibly even fearful. And today, our reading from Paul to the church in Philippi, he seems to be suggesting something which is almost a bigger joke as the angels turning up and saying, "Do not be afraid." He is saying, "Do not be anxious about anything." In other words, don't worry. Advice which seems to fly in the face of human psychology, doesn't it? Because it seems inconceivable that in any normal life we can follow that advice. How can we not worry? Many of our anxieties or fears are almost subconsciously input into our brains at any given time. They sort of trundle across the background of our consciousness without us inviting them to be there, don't they? Now, I've said that generally speaking, I don't get to visit many people these days because I'm just too busy, so pastoral visiting has gone out of the window. But this week I have actually managed to get out of the study to visit two families who are struggling with very difficult relationship problems. They're completely at a loss as to what they should do about these things. And if I rocked up at their front door, knocked on it and said, "Hello, I'm the vicar, oh, and incidentally, don't worry about anything," I'd be unlikely to be invited in for a cup of tea, wouldn't I? So if we read that passage, it seems rather odd, because Paul is a practical bloke. He's not one for being overly sentimental, it's true, but he definitely comes across as a realist. And yet the advice he's giving the church in Philippi seems to come from some sort of dream world. And yet Paul is writing this letter to the church in Philippi from prison. He was a man who had plenty to be concerned about. And he was writing it to a church who, one would imagine, must have had problems that they were worrying about also. Otherwise, why give them the advice? So, if we read on a little bit further, what does Paul suggest? His advice is, pray. But his advice is not, don't worry, just pray, and everything will be fine. Yes, he says, pray in every situation, for big things and for small, for your own problems and for your neighbours and for the world's. Because to not pray about the small things is to assume that God doesn't care about them, or maybe that your concerns are somehow less important than your neighbours or the world. In every situation, Paul says. And if we don't pray for the big things, of course, this is to imply that we don't think God is capable of sorting out the world's big problems. Now, the words that Paul uses for pray are three different words, three different translations. Generally speaking, in the New Testament, when Paul speaks to others and exhorts them to pray, he only uses one. But here he uses all three of them, as though the repetition of the different words for pray should hammer home to us how important his advice is in presenting our requests. We are commanded to pray about the small things and the big things, and to pray with thanksgiving. This is one of the things that sets aside the Christian faith from others. Many people pray, but often they do it only when they need something. Atheists, it seems, in a recent poll, pray quite often, but usually only when the cat has hit the fan. It's a sort of break glass in case of emergency situation. Paul says, no, we pray with thanksgiving. We pray in every situation, for both big things and small. And then he says, leave things with God. Often folks say to me, I don't understand how you can cope with the bad news that people often tell you, with visiting people who are dying, praying for the sick, and hearing people's stories when they turn to you for counselling. It must be incredibly awful, very difficult for you. And I would then say to them, well, I try to be a conduit, not a receptacle. This is Paul's advice when we're tempted to worry, or be fearful or anxious. We pray by leaving things with God. We present our requests to God as something for him to keep. That's what God invites us to do in every situation, both big and small, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving because we are grateful for it. We present our requests to God and leave them with him. He invites us to come to him thankfully and lay our requests at his feet. Not to then forget about them, not that they are no longer relevant to us, but asking him to intervene, to act with specific requests, and then leave it to him to get on with it, knowing that our needs are in his capable hands. And that way, the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard our hearts and minds in Jesus Christ. Not that they will disappear, all our worries and our fears will be gone as if by magic, and that we won't occasionally feel anxious or afraid or worried, but that the peace of God will keep us safe. Because now God is involved. God joins us with our worries and our anxiety, and God can lift them. Lighten the load. When we pray, we're leaving things with the God who loves us and the God who is all-powerful. We're leaving things with the God of peace. And when we do that, the God of peace stands guard over us. He might not always tell us his plans. He isn't always going to answer our prayers in the way that we think he should. But he knows what we're going through, and he is there, faithfully standing with us. And so little by little, we learn to hand things over to him. And we learn little by little that if we've left them with the God of peace, then we can have that peace too. And the more that that becomes our reaction, then the less we'll feel afraid, less we'll feel worried, and the less we'll feel anxious. And the more we'll find that God starts to come alongside us in our anxious moments, and our hearts and our minds will be safe. Let's pray. God our Father, in your love and goodness, grant us the help of your Spirit as we bring to you our prayers for the world and the salvation of mankind. You've taught us to overcome our fear and our anxiety with prayer, and we come to you now with all our hopes and worries. Father God, we thank you for this Advent season, for the hope it offers in this time of anxiety and doubt. The hope signalled by the birth of your Son, perfect and sinless and yet fully human, sent to restore a relationship with you, which means we can call you Abba, Father. We thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit sent by you to be with us, to walk with us, and to reassure us. And we thank you for the greater hope of the return of Christ, who will wipe away every tear and make all things new. We pray for the governments of the world and all the world leaders, that they may uphold what is right for peaceful union between all countries. And we present you with our fears over armed conflict, which seems to loom large between superpowers on countries' borders. Our fears over famines, conflicts and refugees, economic issues and bad decisions. We pray for our country still in the grip of COVID and the new Omicron variant. We think particularly of the reinstatement of restrictions and our fears of being separate from families at Christmas. We pray for our churches, and we present to you our fears and anxiety over the threat of our finances and congregation numbers, over the strain of maintaining buildings and grounds, and over our anxiety about lack of services and priests. And Lord, we pray for ourselves. Help us to be conduits, not containers, at our time of anxiety and fear, passing our fears onto you and so entering into that peace which you provide, which passes all understanding. And we gather our prayers together, those of worship and of supplication, in the Lord's Prayer, as we say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And now it's time for our next hymn, If I Could See. And this is a new hymn. Maybe something that we can, an introduction to me as well as to you, because I only found it this week when I was looking for suitable hymns, and I think it's rather lovely.
In Christ alone.
So before you go out into the world reassured, ready to bring your hopes and fears, anxieties and all that you are to the Creator God, a final blessing. You are called and loved by God the Father and kept safe by Jesus Christ. May his mercy, his peace and love be yours in abundance. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and those whom you love, today and always. Amen. Until we meet again, my friends, hopefully in the flesh over this Christmas season, may God hold you all in the palm of his hand. God bless.